There has been so much tempest in my life, but the quiet places in which my childhood was spent, and the quiet voices that sounded there, seem to me sometimes not to have belonged to my life at all, but to have been part of the life of another, of whom I have heard or read, or whom I have imagined. One whom I can observe with considerable detachment as the story of his days pieces itself together in my mind again, and his dreams come back to me. And continually my thoughts have gone back to the places that were first familiar to me, and my ear has heard the voices that it first heard. I was born in the city of Dublin on the 10th of November 1879. My father was an Englishman, a sculptor. On my mother's side, I can go back to a great-great-grandfather, Walter Brady of Knobber in the County Meath. He fought in 98. When my father and my mother married, there came together two very widely remote traditions. Freedom loving both. And these two traditions worked in me and, prized together by a certain fire proper to myself, made me an Irish rebel, or rather, made me the strange thing I am.
Irish men and Irish women, in the name of God and of the dead generations from which she receives her old tradition of nationhood, Ireland, through us, summons her children to her flag and strikes for her freedom.
Patrick Pearce and his brother Willie were born at number 27 Great Brunswick Street, the street that bears their name today. It was here that their father, James Pearce, established a stonemasonry business in the 1850s, a business which flourished and provided the Pearces with a comfortable middle-class upbringing.
The home life of Patrick Pearce was one where he was surrounded by books. The father had very little formal education. He was a craftsman, he was a stonemason, but like the classic Victorian that you'll find in the writings of Thomas Hardy, who was himself a stone carver, he was a self-educated man. He was not a didact. A huge thirst and hunger for knowledge.
Rud a hatning morlum fe aherent fersig na, gur creche, any one gur creche is sirche nairn, ach, creche e kultur nairn, agus e bishnus doi da des na priv farsna, mandala tishma horia fersig, a sprague kundol ischak, a skull, skull nam roiher noi, a rein irer emlaklia, en a chrse olas na chéadúr mianga na gaeilge.
Pearce was an intelligent and industrious student, but suffered from extreme shyness as a child. Growing up, he had a stammer and a squint in his eye, which contributed to his awkwardness. He would favour a side profile in photographs when he was older. On leaving school, he joined the Gaelic League and became immersed in the Irish cultural revival. Although he went on to study law and qualified as a barrister, it was in the language movement that his future lay.
Dina a curvans leorb, Margaret ananum ingaidia, goods cartsochi. Agus vish an eins lee aganomshin, the anum of a hingaidia. Vidina a gunner gaidia, a chap gomachart, nav him a yenna runs leeshin, a vim persochi waver, unsi a churrans leeshin, pre chosni, a hirsun keen, a andaur, hepper and a chosni, a hrodche. Níl saman níar sin tada fuin chumas mar díadór, beidze go renda brehúna tlénta in aí agus bachumma kerta yentfi. Ach bachuid zé sin chanachta sa vi egia ag íra kerta tangan a wain samach.
We advise all Gaels to simply ignore the British law that makes it penal for them to use their own language to the exclusion of English. If they are summoned and fined, let them refuse to pay. If they are sent to prison, let them go to prison. The question can be brought to a head, no other way.
Pierce wasn't what I would call an extremist. He wasn't a Republican in these early days. The most prominent people, Dr. Hyde, John McNeill, George Moonan, Agnes O'Farrelly, and these who were most active on the Cuistagnóthach, they would be all supporters of the power of John Redmond and the Parliamentary Party.
In 1903, Pierce was elected to the Executive Committee of the Gaelic League and became editor of the organisation's paper, and Clive Sulish, a position previously held by one of the founders of the Gaelic League, Owen McNeill.
Tán hagarócail is grise mar agarthóir an Clive Sulish late agam, agus cursi cultúrthas mó atá fwy capital aga, agus conspóidí litera fwy arclan na manistrach agus le heid. An príomh chuspóir a bhí aga ins na leihantí sin na scríonóirach na Gaelge a chur chan tosig. Seachas éon rud polaitiúil. Is dócha go raibh sé géirí afeocha na Gaeilge chur i gcríoch agus scríonóireacht iathamplach a chur ar fáil, aistí a scrí, gearscéalt a scrí ar nós Isagán. Agus ar ndóigh, d'éirigh leis gearscéal nua aimsrithe, Orbert sa Gaeilge, mar a dúirt Martin O'Kane chlach sé an oscailt phléascach bhí sé faoi anáil mópasáin agus mór gearscéalaithe na hárpa. Agus ar bhealachtas dócha gur ceap sé go bhéadach sé na cosbóirí sin a chur chun tosaigh gan ghlacha le polaitíochta.
Is beag baint a bhí aige bírsach le cuairsaí míleata i raibh seachtain na Cásca, mar níor a mór an óla sé cuairsaí míleata. Tá scéal an go raibh sé na heasa i lár mar de bhig a fosta agus go raibh sé sa mealach ar dhaoine eile agus go raibh sé Tom Clark ba chearr dhaoine cinnt eile peán agus pápa ar a thalgann bheith sin agus ligean go bheith scríomh. Agus ar bhealach siad na forógraí a scríomh sé an seachtain sin an rud is suntasaí chá chuid éibre béidir.
The Republican forces hold the lines. Taken up at 12 noon on Easter morning. And nowhere, despite fierce and almost continuous attacks of the British troops, have the lines been broken through. The country is rising. In answer to Dublin's call, and the final achievement of Ireland's freedom is now, with the gods' help, only a matter of days. The valor, self-sacrifice, and discipline of Irish men and women are about to win for our country a glorious place among the nations.
Bhealach bus glóirí scríonóirí filí na daoine sin agus ní honan son sa rá gur fir mhíleata iad. Dinú comóru orthu in gheall ar an éirí amach ach ar bhealach níl sé sin ceart mar go príomha tá tábhacht leis an bírsach mar theoricóir liberálach i gcúrsaí oideachais a chur an bhéim agónaí ar an báiste féin seachas ar an gcóras ar an ábhar féin agus ní ar thurthaí scrúdaithe. Tá meá scrí stair an idechas san tír seo, de bhíoh anhabhacht leis an bírsach. Béidir gur aonanta sé le Tomás Dávís a dúirt "Educate and you may be free". Mar ar bhealach tá macála an ráite sin le clos ón bírsach. Éire ní amháin gaelach ach saor, ní amháin saor ach gaelach. Thig sé cuacht an idechas.
he understood very clearly governmental theory and colonial theory, and he could see what the British were doing, trying to denature Irish culture. The Japanese studied the British model before they invaded Korea, and they had four professors who spent a lot of time in the British Museum studying how it was done, extirpation of local culture, inculcation of feelings of inferiority, break up the traditional land system, and above all, language. And Pierce recognised that, and he saw education as the method of, you know, freeing the country. That was what his initial impulse was, and teaching the Irish language.
Smalls, education is about fostering. Their education was about repression. Education should be about inspiring young minds. Theirs was about taming it. The modern education system as it stands, it's just turning our boys into things.
Pierce opened St. Enda's, Ireland's first bilingual school, in Ranelagh in September 1908. Amongst those who taught there were his brother Willie and a young colleague of Pierce's from the Gaelic League, Tomás McDonagh.
Tuiscar scríbhneoir é an McDonagh, a suíochar greibh an character cénige a réiteach le character fírsig, sé sin cúrsa a líne, agus a mar sin sort na háta sin na principle agus na haimene céna. Dar ní idir hardh a cardúla céile. Agus le fíria, bú gynna sort cúin cúchlach éig a pársanta an pírsach. Ac ba é McDonagh an téintin ma dérfa garaís é cardúlais agus a bhí mar sort gná chára sóisialt éig.
Pierce was frightfully shy. He was also very reserved. But on this occasion, anyhow, we went out to see McDonagh in St. Enda's, which was at this time in Rathfarnham. And we were all standing in the library talking, when McDonagh suddenly got me by the arm and said, come outside, John, I want to talk to you about something. So I went out, leaving my sister in the room with Pearson. Will you see Pierce? Will you see Pierce? He won't stay in the room for a minute with her. And the next thing, the door opened, and Pierce shot down the passage with his head down, like as if he was pursued by devils. It's so funny.
In 1910, Pierce transferred St. Enda's to a new premises, the Hermitage in Rathfarnham, a beautiful 18th-century house steeped in Irish history.
I live in a place that is very full of heroic memories. In the room in which I work at St. Enda's College, Robert Emmet is said often to have sat. Through our wood runs a path which is called Emmet's Walk. They say that he and Sarah Kern walked there.
Mar níomhán go raibh Macaulay Emmet le feiceáil san áit, ach thosa Saol Emmet agus Gníomhra Emmet a taobh seo an fírsaí de atá rá, agus thosa sé féin a ghol sa tró a chua Emmet de atá rá. Seachas a bheith plé le cúrsaí cultúr agus a tuairt scóil le cúrsaí polisiachta. Thig sé go gcaithfidh sé forbairt mar prodaí, go gcaithfidh sé troid a chur suas, go gcaithfí rialtas na Breataine in éirinn a leagan. Agus feicim muid tró níos polatúla saothar na fírsaí ón am sin amach.
No failure, judged as the world judges these things, was ever more complete, more pathetic than Emmet's. And yet he has left us a prouder memory than the memory of Brian victorious at Clontarf, or of Owen Roe victorious at Benburb. It is the memory of a sacrifice, Christ-like in its perfection. In Emmet, the spirit of Irish patriotism called to a dreamer, and he awoke a man of action. It called to a student and a recluse, and he stood forth a leader of men. It called to one who loved the ways of peace, and he became a revolutionary.
In April 1903, Patrick Pearse travelled to the village of Rosmoke, deep in the Connemara Gaeltacht. He fell in love with the area and its people, and travelled there every summer. By 1910, he had built himself a summer home there, overlooking Lough Aroulach.
Totu rogarca on it fain a fersic. Ni yen and tu cadre of Luguel, shen and tu a goluder. Nor a hagas tu in a mask. Tagan maravyuk, neil dove e ducker, agus leon or who. Antea vi contic riv yachtich, bin shen a host, antea vi galgoric, tagan groom er. An ea nil hosnic on it is kuntikle shin, niadar. Is doi lum go wil ga fersakon, far grooma dinanta, agus far gyal sinanta. Ni ector an far gyal sinanta, ach ga hanav. Agus isi an quidjas granara din scale, nac oldum kea kun far derka, no an far gyal an pierce kyart.
Zrera chéle shilam a hossa, Pearse chuir spéise gursaí políochtta. Béad a gohhain se leis a tréimhse, na tréimhse sin roimh go mór, bhí an políocht i gcéirí níos géire agus bhadh sé deacair ag daoine gun airde a thuairteir. A chlaic sé haon páirt i bheachtas in 1911 thug rí heas na cuairte ar Vlad Lia agus agraíomh feachtas in aghaidh na cuairte seo. Bhí Pearse páirteach sa bheachtas sin, bhí daoine eile ar nós Eamon Cant agus Sean McDiarmid agus Thomas McDonagh. Bhí sé siúd páirteach sa bheachtas sin chomh maith. Mar sin, thosa sé chur aithne ar poblachtóirí. Thosa sé haon i tuairt óráidí ag cruinne poblachtacha agus de réir chéile tugadh isteach i measc poblachtóirí agus baíar go raibh sé suntasach go leo sa drám sin.
Sean.
Tom. Tom, this is Patrick Pearse. Patrick, Tom Clark.
Patrick.
How do you do, Tom?
How are you?
We'd like to talk to you about the Emmett commemoration that's coming up. Both myself and Tom agree that it's a very important opportunity.
Very special day.
We have one issue, though. We need somebody to make a speech that day.
It's really McDermott who introduces Pearse to Clark, brings him along. Clark and McDermott were looking for a speaker. I hesitate to use the word frontman, but really, to a large extent, that is what he is. Pearse is acting according to the script that Clark and McDermott have devised.
Can I ask you something? If Robert Emmett was heading out there tomorrow, would you follow him?
Is there a man here among us who wouldn't?
Nice to meet you, Patrick.
Although Clark and McDiarmid saw the potential in Pearse, there were others in the IRB who felt he was too moderate. As late as 1912, Pearse was sharing home rule platforms with members of the Irish Parliamentary Party. But even though Pearse was still in favour of home rule, a threat of violence had now entered his speeches.
Ní sirse an racht seo, ach beidir le dia gurbh é tús na sirse é. Ach má cliste ar an dendal seo, tá drámin éireann agus timeshare a gwine riamh. A bhulas do ghaol gan dul i gcóirla ná i gcadraimh le gal go deo arís. Ach iad ar agairt feasta le lámh láidir agus le fuair cliabh. Tuige gal, má fheoltar ar an arís.
The desire to move well beyond home rule is something that evolves. For some people within the Fianna movement, within the Irish Republican Brotherhood, they're quite explicit about that from the first decade of the 20th century, that home rule is in no sense an adequate solution to the problem of Irish nationalism and of defining what the future of Ireland is going to be politically, socially as well. They do not see that as being in any way adequate, and they are quite explicit about that from an early stage. For others who do eventually become involved in the Irish Republican Brotherhood, they are not as explicit or clear-cut are definite about that in the first decade of the 20th century. It evolves, and that's true for people like Patrick Pearse as well, that their political evolution is somewhat more complicated and is somewhat slower.
In Pearse's case, there was also another element that was coming through. His growing disillusionment with the capacity of an entirely cultural project to deliver a culturally fulfilled Ireland, shall we say, an Irish-speaking Ireland. And I think that was partly to do with the failure of the practical project to make his school work. By 1912, Pearse, through his school, was virtually bankrupt. The strain of keeping the school going was enormous. And I think he increasingly attributed that to the hostility of the, in a sense, the political environment, the educationally political environment in which he was operating. He got no support through any state structures, no grant aiding of any particular form for his school. And in a sense, maybe he came to the kind of conclusion that, like, was it Mao that said, you've got to change in a revolution. You know, you don't change the fish, you've got to change the water in which the fish swims. So perhaps Pearse was being pulled in this direction of having to realising that the school, being his fish, needed to swim in different water. And this then gave him the political impulse that we had to change everything about the way Irish life was constructed, including the political framework within which it worked.
Pearse joined the Irish Volunteers at their foundation in November 1913, and he played a central role in the organisation from the beginning. A month later, he was sworn into the IRB by Bulmer Hobson, and it was Hobson who organised a three-month lecture tour for Pearse in the United States in order to raise funds for St. Enda's. In early 1914, Pearse left his brother Willie in charge of the school and he travelled to America. In the US, his speeches became increasingly militant.
I think Pearse was hugely influenced by the outbreak of the First World War as well, particularly the idea of the spilling of blood for a greater end, and the emergence just before that of the Ulster Volunteer Force as well. He seems to become quite intoxicated by the notion of Irish people being armed and being dedicated to a particular cause or dedicated to a particular end and being prepared to make the ultimate sacrifice towards that end. And that does influence Pearse in a very profound way. Pearse was somebody who had a very intense focus on this notion of sacrifice or this notion of idealism. He tended to deal in superlatives a lot of the time. And that theme of blood sacrifice is significant. It's very important for Patrick Pearse in particular.
The young men of this nation stand organized and disciplined and are rapidly taking up arms. Blood has flowed through Dublin streets, and the cause of the volunteers has been consecrated by a Holocaust. The war in Europe has brought about a crisis which may contain, as yet hidden within it, the moment that generations have been waiting for. It remains to be seen whether, if this moment is revealed to us, we shall have the sight to see or courage to do, or whether it will be written of this generation, alone of all the generations of Ireland, that there were none among us who dared to make the ultimate sacrifice. Remember, England's difficulty is Ireland's opportunity.
The Great War was the opportunity that the IRB had been waiting for, and it was decided to stage a rising before the end of the war. A military council was formed, and Pearse was appointed to it. With plans for a rising underway, the IRB were looking to stage an event that would rally public support to their cause. And when the old Fenian Jeremiah O'Donovan Rossa died, it was decided to mark the occasion with a major display of nationalist strength.
Agus Historikur chuidisheil insin an ina ulavo lai trada. Agus bhí an óráid sin an táhachtach le daine a dhrísa agus a thuir de chéile agus an tochrid ar fad ba rud mór é ar a mánach go dtíon éirí meach choíre.
They think they have pacified Ireland. They think that they have purchased half of us and intimidated the other half. That they have purchased half of us and intimidated the other half. They think that they have purchased half of us and intimidated the other half. They think they have purchased half of us and intimidated the other half. They think they have foreseen everything, that they have provided against everything. But the fools. They have left us our Fenian dead. And while Ireland holds these graves, Ireland unfree shall never be at peace.
They think they have pacified Ireland. They think they have purchased half of us and intimidated the other half. They think they have foreseen everything, that they have provided against everything. But the fools! The fools! The fools! They have left us our Fenian dead! And while Ireland holds these graves, Ireland unfree shall never be at peace!
One man can free a people. As one man redeemed the world. I will take no pike. I will go into battle with bare hands. I will stand up before the goal as Christ hung naked before men on a tree. And I say to my people's masters, beware. Beware of the thing that is to come. Beware of the risen people who shall take what ye would not give.
On Easter Monday 1916, rebel forces occupied various points throughout Dublin City. Pearse was at the head of the Republican forces that marched from Liberty Hall to the GPO. At about 1:45, in his role as president of the Provisional Government of the Irish Republic, Pearse stood in front of the GPO and he read aloud the Proclamation of the Irish Republic.
Irishmen and Irish women! In the name of God and of the dead generations from which she receives her old tradition of nationhood, Ireland, through us, summons her children to her flag and strikes for her freedom.
Shame on you.
In retrospect, it probably seems more dramatic than it actually was. I think if you look at the proclamation, it reads very well. And it's a document, I think, which is very generous in spirit. And I think it stood the test of time. But of course, in the middle of effectively what was the start of a war, you have crowds milling around, you have people confused, what on earth is going on here? So I don't think Pierce had the kind of audience at which he was his best. So the impact, I think the impact was something of an anticlimax.
In this supreme hour, the Irish nation must, by its valour, discipline, and by the readiness of its children to sacrifice themselves for the common good, prove itself worthy of the august destiny to which it is called.
Don't fight France, will you?
Signed on behalf of the Irish Provisional Government.
Thanks be to God, Pierce. You've lived to see this day.
Pierce, I can die a happy man. I've lived to see the greatest day in Irish history.
On the wall.
We've got to be very careful when we talk about public opinion or public mind. It's actually quite difficult to discern how exactly the public reacted in 1916. If you consider that after the second day of the Rising, journalists, for example, were not allowed to go into the firing line, what we do have instead are testimonies from people who were there at the time that do give or do reflect this notion of hostility. Robert Holland, for example, who was in Marrowbone Lane, talked about the reaction when they were being led from Marrowbone Lane to Richmond Barracks, that there was this act of public hostility, that the British soldiers actually had to protect the Irish rebels from the barracking public. Shoot those Sinn Féin bastards, is what some of them were saying. They didn't know who these individuals were or what they were trying to do, but they did know that it caused not only huge inconvenience, it also caused serious civilian casualties. And if you look at the breakdown of those who were killed during the Easter Rising, you can see that 62 rebels were killed, 132 British soldiers were killed, but 256 civilians were killed. So it's quite clear who bore the brunt of the suffering and of the death in Easter week 1916. It was the civilians. So it's hardly any surprise that there would have been that degree of hostility at that time.
A number of the dead were lying around, civilians, soldiers, and volunteers. One of the civilian casualties was squatting against a wall with a white bundle. His head was split open like a pomegranate. A volunteer was lying at the corner of Moor Lane, a dead Tommy beside him. I'll never forget that little volunteer. They played a machine gun on him. Pieces of wool, his undergarments protruded through his uniform, making a scarecrow character of a man.
Is Dacher boy on fubble a vas, agus ni federe a yen of an ish, co father son in a year, agus lair on the Turishki, a tugu a noct on vla cleamar hampla, garau reins wat and a dini, in took me hostilish an iria mak, a garon agus a clausen fui, agus few in on na revloja hafena waslu, a deren a shachtena. Egan am kena ma scrudian tu trocta si iscri iri si on astroil agus on astoit enta fein. Is leir gar hacig galor lor dini, cos fwinter na cachrach ac a hoirehe, leis an airi amach, gar hagad ar bula bos fiw dan na cimehe agus i da gimacht. So is leir on na turisgri gar au an tir fein scalte in ngá la.
All citizens of Dublin who believe in the right of their country to be free, will give their allegiance and their loyal help to the Irish Republic. Yeah. We have lived to see an Irish Republic proclaimed. May we live to establish it firmly children and our children's children enjoy the happiness and prosperity which freedom will bring!
He obviously was an inspirational figure, and just having them there would have given them great confidence. But you can see a veiled criticism in, say, in Michael Collins's letter, where he writes, he talked about them afterwards as being some of the finest people God ever put on earth, and it was a privilege to know them. But he wondered whether the middle of a revolution, shot and shell, was that the best time to be issuing poetic, flowing, you know, communiques about how we're marching on this one and that one, and our gallant allies are coming to our aid. I mean, this was all a theatre of the mind, keeping the troops' morale up. They were cut off, and every day brought thousands more troops to the noose was tightening all the time on them. And they were being shelled, and the Friars were gaining on them.
It's to go to the Falklands. If we get as far as Bow Street, then we'll be fine.
Why are we starting evacuations in an hour? Men! We're staying for one more hour. One final stand. I desire now, lest I may not have the opportunity later, to pay homage to the gallantry of the soldiers of Irish freedom, who have, during the past 4 days, been writing with fire and steel the most glorious chapter in the later history of Ireland. Justice can never be done. To your heroism, to your discipline, to your unconquerable spirit, in the midst of peril and death, for 4 days, you have fought and toiled, almost without cessation, almost without sleep, and in the intervals of fighting, you have sung songs of freedom of Ireland. No man has complained. No man has asked why. Each individual has spent himself, happy to pour out his strength for Ireland and for freedom. If we do not win this fight, we will at least have deserved to win it. But win it, we will. Although we may win in death, already we have won a great thing. We have redeemed Dublin from many shames. I am satisfied that we have saved Ireland's honor.
On Friday, the rebels were forced to abandon the GPO. The leaders managed to make their way as far as a small shop on Moore Street, where the military council met for the last time.
Minute of Provisional Government Decision, 29th April, 1916. HQ Moore Street. Believing that the glorious stand which has been made by the soldiers of Irish freedom during the last 5 days in Dublin has been sufficient to gain recognition of Ireland's national claim at an international peace conference, and desirous of preventing further slaughter of the civil population and to save the lives of as many as possible of our followers. The members of the provisional government here present have agreed by a majority to open negotiations with the British commander. P.H. Pierce, Commandant General, Commanding in Chief, Army of the Irish Republic.
At 2:30 on Saturday afternoon, Patrick Pierce walked up Moore Street and surrendered to General Lowe at the corner of Parnell Street. On the 2nd of May, Pierce was tried by court-martial in Richmond Barracks and sentenced to death.
I think Pierce got the result he craved. This is what Pierce would have seen as happening long-term, that these people would be seen as individuals who made the ultimate sacrifice, but in doing so, created a momentum that couldn't be stopped. And if you do see the 1916 Rising, and it's legitimate to see it as, you know, the foundation act of that era of great political upheaval in Ireland that ultimately leads to the creation of a new state, and in time leads to the creation of an Irish Republic, well then, Pierce's view was very legitimate and very accurate in that sense.
This is the death I should have asked for if God had given me the choice of all deaths. To die a soldier's death for Ireland and for freedom. We have done right. People will say hard things of us now, but later on, they will praise us.
Tuairim a phobal i leithan éirí amach. Bhí cúpla rud a gceist, ar nó an chuaigh chur a dhaoine chun báis, chuir sé sin uafás ar dhaoine, go thar is nuair a chuala siad faoi dhaoine chur a chun báis, a bhí tín nó bhí gortaí go donna, agus mar sin de. A chanús ar sin, sílim gur a measaigh dhaoine ar an éirí amach, gur an a dhaoine seo sásta, íirech de dhaoine, agus bhí measaigh dhaoine ar sin, agus thug sé le tuiscint go dhaoine go bhéad faoi seasa in aghaidh impreacht na Breataine. Agus níos fuid anón, nóair a bhí níos mó daoine sástaí sin na dhéanana, bhí imeachtaí 1916 mar spreaga acu.
The Rising had no democratic justification in that sense. But revolutionary conspiracies are like that. They can't wait for a ballot box. They can't openly put their views to the public and get approval. What can be said is that, in a sense, their goal, if not all of their actions, received democratic validation after the event. So in that sense, you could say that, this is dangerous, in that sense, they had gazed into what the Irish people really wanted. In that sense, and they had understood what the Irish people longed for, which was to be free and independent, and they had made their stand for it. The danger was that subsequent movements would also say, we know better than the Irish people what they really want. Whether the men of 1916 would have agreed with subsequent movements that have engaged in that kind of behaviour, I think is very much open to doubt. Shade of heaven, but labour, the bay are great to be even. The good have brought his shell of merla. Stu deal the lashna gala.
Are there any revolutions that deliver on their promises? That's the big question. Is the Irish situation unique in not delivering on the Republic that some of these people envisaged, or some of the values of the Republic that these people envisaged? What was delivered and what did happen was the achievement of political sovereignty. And that was a hugely important part of the legacy of 1916 and the legacy of that revolutionary period generally. When you look at some of the other promises, when you look at some of the other aspects of the proclamation in terms of equality, in terms of a greater degree of social cohesion, you could say that that hasn't been delivered on. So I think in terms of contemporary Ireland, and again, this is going to be discussed, I suspect, quite vigorously around the 100th anniversary of the Easter Rising and the commemoration of that, have we become the Republic of Pearse and Connolly? And there's going to be further debate about that. There's going to be those who will insist that we need to go back to the proclamation, that we still need to strive towards the ideals that are contained in the proclamation.
Oh, Roche the Vahawalia. Oh, Roche the Vahawalia. Oh, Roche the Vahawalia. Gaelid hain is ni gal